There will be a referendum in Quebec. I'm happy. I'm happy with that. I'm not scared.
10 years ago, millions of Canadians were caught in the clash of two very different dreams. Over the next two nights, the dramatic story of one of the most intense events in Canada's history. It's the story of a prime minister who thought he couldn't lose.
I have the best product to offer. Canada.
Of two separatist leaders who staked it all to win. It's a story of political infighting and bruised egos, of uneasy alliances and breathtaking gambles. 10 years ago, Quebec was on the verge of becoming a country. 10 years ago, Canada reached the breaking point.
We intend to make of Quebec a sovereign nation. I think we'll have a country pretty soon.
Acceptez-vous que le Québec...
It was a real question.
It would never be clear enough for them.
It's a reflection of lack of political courage.
I see sovereign Quebec. We have wasted too much money.
Seul le Québec dans Canada.
Build this great country.
C'est un pays.
Divorce today and lovers tomorrow.
We are taking a very dangerous game.
Separate Quebec would be a foreign country.
Si la tendance se maintient.
Period.
Vive le Canada!
C'est vrai qu'on a été battu.
Vous savez que c'est non!
Par l'argent des votes ethniques.
It's a small world, sometimes too small. Jacques Parizeau and Jean Chrétien meet socially for the first time at a Mexican resort during the 1969 Christmas holidays. The wives of the two political opponents make them promise not to talk politics. They agree. A truce is called. Until the day Parizeau boasts that he had studied at the famous London School of Economics and that Chrétien had not. A chill sets in, and the two men avoid each other for the rest of the holiday. It's not surprising, for it's hard to imagine two men more different from each other than Jean Chrétien and Jacques Parizeau. Jean Chrétien is born into a working-class family in rural Quebec, and will have to scrabble for everything he will ever achieve in life. He wants to become an architect, but when he's still in his teens, his father steers him into politics. He will take to that rough and tumble world like a fish to water.
At 13, I was distributing pamphlets and putting the posters on the walls and placing the chairs in the city hall, you know, for the meetings and so on. 15, I was debating with him politics in the pool room next door.
Jacques Parizeau is born into a well-to-do Montreal family. He goes to the finest private schools and to the best European universities. Perfectly bilingual, he has the temperament of an aristocrat and a passion for teaching. He will wade into the swamp of politics only because there's no way around it. But he'll never feel comfortable there.
You go into politics because you have to, in a sense, use politics to achieve certain objectives. But in itself, there's nothing particularly, as far as I'm concerned, it's not something I like.
During the 1960s, Quebec is in constant turmoil. Thousands of youths campaign to make Quebec an independent country. Others choose to assert the French fact within Canada. Like many of their friends, Jacques Parizeau and Jean Chrétien have to pick a side. Jean Chrétien chooses Canada and is elected in 1963. He arrives in Ottawa, unable to speak a word of English. The nation's capital is like a foreign city, and Chrétien is tempted for a while to pursue his political career in Quebec City. But Prime Minister Lester Pearson has been courting young Quebecers like him to counter the rise of nationalism in the province. They have a heart-to-heart talk.
He said, John, you know, do whatever you want, but I would appreciate it if you would stay. And the only question he asked me, he said, you know, do you believe in Canada? And I said, yes, I do.
Jacques Parizeau chooses Quebec. He becomes one of the brilliant technocrats of the Quiet Revolution who transformed Quebec into a modern state. It soon dawns on him that Quebec has all it needs to be an independent country.
Mon adhésion au Parti Québécois entraînera...
In 1969, Parizeau jumps into politics. He joins René Lévesque's new Parti Québécois. This is not a passionate nationalist. For him, it's a purely intellectual decision.
I was a government man. A technocrat without a soul, as I was once described. It is much later that I started to discover, in a sense, what the Quebec public was, who they were, these people, and started to be quite attached.
J'ai jamais pensé que je pouvais être aussi fier d'être Québécois que ce soir.
In 1976, the sovereignists in Quebec come to power. A confrontation with Canada is inevitable. René Lévesque announces his intention to hold a referendum on separation. In Ottawa, the federal government has to face a hard question. Is Canada divisible?
Dans un référendum, comme nous l'avons promis.
We had a debate at that time. A lot of people argued that Canada is indivisible, just like France. Mr. Trudeau, and producing myself too, came to the conclusion that we'll trust the democracy.
Jean Chrétien is the federal government's point man in the 1980 campaign.
Moi aussi, j'aurais voulu qu'on gagne la bataille des plaines d'Abraham. J'étais pas là pour réveiller mon calme pendant que Wolf est monté durant la nuit. Si j'avais été là, je l'aurais réveillé, puis on... Ben correct, mais on l'a pas gagné.
Jacques Parizeau fights loyally alongside René Lévesque, even though he believes that his boss's desire for a new partnership with Canada is a strategic mistake.
We can dream as much as we want about that kind of a partnership. To my mind, these, for the moment, are words. If there is a partnership, it's obviously English Canada that will determine its existence. After all, there are three English Canadians for one Quebecer. We're not going to impose anything on Canada.
Gary, if I can interrupt you at this moment,
yes,
while you're on Crescent Street, we're now on the basis of returns so far, the CBC is able to project a victory for the no side.
On May 20th, 1980, the Federalists win convincingly over the Sovereignists. Jean Chrétien believes that the issue is settled for a very long time. Jacques Parizeau wants a rematch.
Si je vous ai bien compris, vous êtes en train de dire à la prochaine fois.
There will be, as René Lévesque says, a next time. And Jacques Parizeau and Jean Chrétien will be in command. But it will be another player, an ardent admirer of René Lévesque, who will turn that contest into an epic battle, the likes of which the country has never seen. Lucien Bouchard has always been deeply passionate, even as a youth. His keen mind will make him one of the most eloquent orators of his generation. A lawyer by training, he's a superb negotiator. He's always looking for an edge, anything to strengthen his hand. In 1988, he joins Brian Mulroney's conservative government. He is the point man for the Meech Lake Accord, which would have recognized Quebec as a distinct society in the Canadian Constitution.
Il est nu, le Québec, devant les neuf autres provinces. Il s'est mis à nu.
When the accord dies in 1990, Lucien Bouchard turns his back on federalism.
Maintenant que les partenaires déchirent la signature, il n'a plus rien à donner, le Québec.
So do many Quebecers. They are hurt and very angry.
Il faudra toujours se rappeler que l'avenir du Québec.
Celebrated actor Jean Duceppe vows that Quebec's future will never again be determined by anyone else.
Vive le Québec!
A wave of nationalism sweeps through the province.
I, Jean Chrétien Duceppe.
The 1993 federal election brings together all the ingredients for a new clash between Quebec and English Canada. Jean Chrétien becomes prime minister and pledges not to reopen constitutional talks.
So, help me God.
Je jure que je serai fidèle, que je serai fidèle, que je porterai vraie allégeance, et porterai vraie allégeance à Sa Majesté la Reine Elisabeth II. À Sa Majesté la Reine Elisabeth II.
Lucien Bouchard becomes leader of the opposition. The Bloc Québécois' sole purpose is to wrench Quebec out of Canada. Western Canada is up in arms too. Preston Manning and his Reform Party have come to Central Canada to shake up the federal government. Jean Chrétien is caught between a rock and a hard place, but as long as there's a federalist government in Quebec City, he's safe. That won't last. In the summer of 1994, Jacques Parizeau is a happy man. He's now the leader of the Parti Québécois, and in a few weeks, he expects to be the premier of Quebec. Ever since the 1980 sovereignist defeat, he has been fine-tuning his own strategy. He's not at all interested in being a premier, and will hold a referendum in 8 to 10 months. He is determined not to repeat René Lévesque's mistake. This time, there is no way on earth that he will allow sovereignty to be dependent on a deal with English Canada. On September 12th, 1994, he's elected Premier of Quebec. But there's a dark cloud on the horizon. Since the death of Meech Lake, the sovereignists have been on a roll. A year ago, almost half of Quebecers voted for Lucien Bouchard and the Bloc Québécois. Tonight, Parizeau has won only 44% of the votes. It's a step back and a very weak springboard towards a referendum.
Nous allons leur poser.
Lucien Bouchard smells danger. Jacques Parizeau couldn't care less. He hasn't waited this long to slow down now.
The Bloc Québécois leader Lucien Bouchard went to hospital on Tuesday complaining of leg pain.
The infection that has entered his body has moved with lightning speed.
On a cold December day in 1994, Lucien Bouchard's life is forever altered.
People say Lucien Bouchard is in serious condition. Other sources say he is in critical condition.
Called necrotizing myositis. It strikes few, but when it does, it's often fatal.
I hope that soon
it will just have been a very bad dream. Hang on, old friend.
He's got courage. If he's got faith, maybe he'll go through this. We all hope so.
Lui souhaitons un prompt rétablissement, espérons que ce n'est pas aussi grave que on nous l'a laissé entendre jusqu'à ce moment-ci.
Aujourd'hui, dans sa lutte intime, tout un peuple est derrière lui. Merci, Monsieur le Président.
I woke up, my wife was close to me, and the room appeared to be full of doctors, maybe only one, only two, but my recollection is that there was a crowd of doctors, and they had solemn faces, they were grave, and it was a sinister atmosphere. I could feel it, you know. And then one of them began to talk and explained to me that he had to cut my leg, and it was a question of life and death.
A few of his colleagues are allowed into the hospital. They come out overwhelmed. Anxious supporters wait outside for even the slightest bit of news. Inside, Lucien Bouchard comes to grips with the full horror of his situation.
Of course, never anything in my life prepared me to live such a moment. I turned to Audrey, you know? And she told me, we have no choice, Lucien. There is no choice, you know, when it comes to life and death. You don't have any choice. And I have small children and all reasons to live. So of course I said yes.
In the tiny village of his birth, people pray for the favorite son, as do many Canadians.
C'était mon petit frère qui était malade. On avait besoin encore de Lucien Bouchard. On en avait besoin. Quand même mutilé, on en avait besoin. C'est pour ça que j'ai prié.
They weren't just praying for Lucien Bouchard in the province of Quebec. I can tell you, somebody said across from the floor of the house that he was in my prayers as well, and the prayers of many Canadians.
I remember praying for him that night on the way home to my place in Edmonton, and also wondering what this would do to the whole cause of separatism, because he was the magnetism. He was the guy that everybody put so much faith in.
Having lost Bouchard at this point, it would have nourished something that is very present in the political culture of Quebec. It's the failure syndrome. Is that when Quebecers try to collectively make an important decision whether to reform the place of Quebec within Canada or try to leave Canada, it fails. It had just failed at Meech, it had failed in 1980. And so it seemed to be on the cusp of victory, and we would have lost our best player. So to my mind, it would have given the signal that we're somehow damned.
For 36 hours, everyone fears the worst. Finally, the doctors signal a first ray of hope. Lucien Bouchard will make it.
We can presume, with the bacteriological test that we've had, that the infection is under control.
One doctor holds up a note scribbled by Bouchard during his ordeal. It's a simple message, but a potent symbol. Carry on. Thank you. While Bouchard is in rehabilitation, one overriding question is on everyone's mind. Will he resume his political career? For many Canadians, federalists and sovereignists alike, the fate of the referendum hangs on the answer. Washington, capital of the most powerful country on the planet. Quebec, as a mere Canadian province, has no diplomatic status here. And yet, Jacques Parizeau must seduce the Americans, for an independent Quebec could not survive for long without their support and goodwill. History and two ambassadors stand in his way.
This is not fertile ground for separatism or ideas of independence. For the Americans have fought the bloodiest war of their history, civil war, more than 500,000 dead. So when you talk of the threat of separation, or they perceived our debate very much in the context of their own history, their civil war. So everywhere I went, in the months leading to the referendum, I always saw on the faces of people I was talking to an expression of fear, emotion, uncertainty, because of the relationship they were making between our debate and their own civil war.
The Canadian ambassador dominates the diplomatic playing field. Quebec is allowed only a tourism bureau. And as if testifying to the special relationship between the two countries, the Canadian embassy sits on prime real estate, only steps away from Capitol Hill.
I'm signing my appointment.
Then there's James Blanchard. The American ambassador to Canada is one of Bill Clinton's close friends. He quickly becomes a thorn in Jacques Parizeau's side. Blanchard supports Canada wholeheartedly, and he's not shy about saying so, even if the official American line, the mantra, is that it is up to Canadians to determine their own future.
That mantra was being used by the hardliners in Quebec is to say the U.S. doesn't really care, or we'll have better relations with the U.S. if we separate from Canada, or everything will be the same. We'll have NAFTA, we'll have, you know, the Auto Pact, we'll have NORAD, NATO, we'll have all this. And the Americans don't really care. It doesn't matter to them. In fact, they're probably secretly on our side because we love them so much. And that's the kind of stuff I was hearing all over as I moved around.
These are not the only roadblocks. Parizeau has to contend with yet another opponent who is tarnishing Quebec's reputation in the United States. For many years, the James Bay Cree have taken their fight against Quebec's massive hydroelectric projects to the world. Now, the Cree use these same occasions to alert the international community to a new menace, Parizeau's sovereignty project.
We weren't denying Quebec their right to determine their own future or to exercise their right of self-determination. We weren't denying that they had the right. What we're saying was, if you claim that right of self-determination, do not deny that same right to apply to the First Nations people, in this case, to the Crees of Quebec.
More importantly, to look at the social, cultural impact.
Kuhnkamp knows that Parizeau wants to project a positive image in the U.S. While he's in Washington to oppose the Great Whale hydroelectric project, he denounces Parizeau's claim that the Cree have surrendered their territorial rights.
But this is an assertion that Mr. Parizeau should be ashamed to make. The notion of extinguishment of Aboriginal rights now stands condemned as outdated, colonial, and racist practice.
Parizeau must strike quickly to muzzle the Cree. Without warning, he cancels the $13 billion power project.
Ce projet, il est sur la glace pour un bon bout de temps, sinon.
I just pulled the plug and said, no development of Great Whale. All the discussion stopped.
The Cree lose their platform, at least for now. But Parizeau has accomplished nothing more than damage control. However, he prides himself on having a quick mind and a knack for clever solutions. He'll get to Washington by way of Paris. Jacques Parizeau firmly believes that France and the other French-speaking nations will quickly recognize his new country. France and Quebec have forged close diplomatic ties over the past decades, often much to Ottawa's annoyance. In Paris, Parizeau can hold his head high. Here, he's welcomed like a true head of state. But he also courts the French because he has convinced himself that the Americans, not to be outdone by France, will recognize an independent Quebec first. This is Jacques Parizeau's great game, though he may well be the only player.
The great game was to use the support of France in such a way that it would, in a way, threaten the United States of recognizing an independent Quebec first. Something that we knew the Americans just couldn't tolerate.
It seems to me an interesting exercise in Cartesian logic, but to make assumptions about a U.S. reaction because the French move first, I think, probably is useless speculation.
In January of 1995, Parizeau is welcomed with full honors at City Hall by Jacques Chirac, Paris's mayor, and also a leading contender in the French presidential race.
En fait, il nous appartient pas de juger à la place des Québécois.
Jacques Chirac says that it's not up to him to decide for Quebecers. But if they choose independence, France must be among the first to recognize the fact.
Pas seulement les nations françaises, nous devons être naturellement parmi les premiers.
Parizeau meets everyone who matters in the French capital.
Et que vous étiez de surcroît un homme de décision.
The diplomatic pomp and circumstance feeds his love of protocol and ceremony. While it fuels Jean Chrétien's growing irritation, the Canadian ambassador to France tries hard to calm Chrétien down.
Que nous vous reconnaîtrons toujours.
I was begging the Prime Minister to remain quiet. Whatever provocation will be seen by Ottawa, please, sir, forget the flags, forget the red carpet. Just go to the substance of the debate.
But Jean Chrétien jokes that Quebec has about as much of a chance of becoming independent as Jacques Chirac of becoming president of France. The great game is on. Both France and the United States will make themselves heard during the campaign. In 1995, Lucien Bouchard returns to Parliament Hill barely 12 weeks after his illness. It is an unforgettable moment. The sovereignist movement has regained its soul. Many had thought that he would not return to politics, that his brush with death would have altered his priorities. Instead, he says, it served as a lesson in life. He has learned how precious time is. And with the referendum clock ticking, time is something he is no longer willing to waste. He wants to play an active role. His return is a potent tonic for his colleagues and for their cause.
Mais il y a
la première chose que je vais vous dire, c'est que vous m'avez manqué. Vous ne pouvez pas imaginer à quel point vous m'avez manqué.
During my days in the hospital, during my darkest days, darkest hours, one of my motivations, maybe not the main ones, but one of them was to be able someday, as soon as possible, to stand up. Because when you lost a leg, the symbol of being able to stand up is so important, so strong, and in a public place like the house, where I stand up to ask my first question, it would be a great moment for me, a great moment.
Bouchard has become a symbol of courage and determination. Both his allies and his opponents sense this, but they don't yet realize just how powerful this transformation has made him.
Here is this man who, having come so close to his end, who had a young family, a young wife, would choose to come back to Parliament, come back to his work. It made the value of his work that much greater, that he would come back to it, notwithstanding his near-death experience. And so it made people pay more attention to what he was saying.
But after, will we have better jobs? I just can't sign a blank check. I just can't say, let's vote for sovereignty, and then we'll see what happens.
Before I decide whether I'm for or against sovereignty, I need to know what it will cost.
You know, this isn't like buying a pair of underwear.
While Lucien Bouchard was recovering, Jacques Parizeau set up a province-wide commission to rally support for a spring referendum. The hearings are widely covered, but instead of solidarity, people seem filled with doubt.
There's no answer being given to questions like the cost of sovereignty.
It's about our nation. It's about our culture.
Quebecers are more concerned than enthusiastic. They find Jacques Parizeau and his plan too radical. They feel rushed, and they fear that he may be leading them straight to disaster.
I'm going to vote against sovereignty if it's held in June, because that's too soon.
As winter wanes, the polls confirm that there is no trend towards sovereignty. 60% of Quebecers would vote no. Lucien Bouchard has been listening to the people. Jacques Parizeau wants sovereignty, period. He believes that common interests will dictate a certain cooperation between Canada and Quebec once the dust is settled. But Bouchard understands that most Quebecers want to keep some special link with their neighbor. At his very first press conference, Lucien Bouchard stakes out his ground. Unlike Parizeau, who seems ready to bulldoze ahead despite the polls, Bouchard argues that the Yes forces must provide Quebecers with the reassurance they seek.
On March
12th, Lucien Bouchard decides to act, knowing that many anxious sovereignists back him. He's going to challenge Jacques Parizeau. Bouchard wants Parizeau to offer Canada a partnership and to hold a second referendum before declaring Quebec's independence. For Jacques Parizeau, this is heresy. The two men meet in the privacy of the Premier's home in Montreal. A battle of titans has begun.
He wanted to commit to a second referendum where the population of Quebec would ratify the new agreement or treaty or whatever between Quebec and Canada, as was the case in 1980 question. Now, this was for Mr. Parizeau and for the Council of Ministers and the PQ out of the question. There would be no return to the two referendum scenario, and Mr. Bouchard knew that.
For them, it was, in a sense, a sort of soft approach to the one that I was proposing. Mr. Bouchard was, at one point, I think, quite tempted by that approach. The only problem is that it was quite incompatible with the sort of approach that I had been setting up for several years. For years, I had said repeatedly on all kinds of rostrums that here is where we're going. I'm going to have a referendum to achieve sovereignty. not open negotiations, not ask permission to achieve it, to do it.
Jacques Parizeau believes he has nipped the challenge in the bud, but he's wrong. Over the next few weeks, he'll be buffeted from all sides.
Nos troupes ne veulent pas être envoyées dans une à l'abattoir.
First, by his own deputy premier, Bernard Landry, who compares Parizeau's strategy to the ill-fated charge of the Light Brigade that ended in a quick and massive slaughter.
L'irresponsabilité de ses commandants.
Several years have passed since that. And when I think about that one, I still don't like to comment it. I'm not sure I could keep my my calm. So I won't comment it.
His plans in disarray, Jacques Parizeau has to retreat, for now. Clearly irritated, he announces that the referendum cannot be held in the spring. But that's not enough to satisfy Lucien Bouchard, and he renews his attack. By now, he's convinced that Parizeau would rather run the risk of defeat than change his strategy. Bouchard again insists on an offer of partnership or association with Canada. 3 weeks after their first encounter, they face each other again at the Delta Hotel in Montreal.
I know that at some point Bouchard understood that there were no takers at the cabinet table in Quebec for the second referendum, so he backed off. We know that now. We didn't know that then. You know, he seemed to be very adamant about it. So what he was signaling was that tinkering on the edges with association was not enough. We needed much more.
A week later, the Bloc Québécois holds its convention. Lucien Bouchard has gotten nowhere with Parizeau. So, with carefully chosen words, he condemns Parizeau's strategy.
Le projet souverainiste doit prendre rapidement un virage.
He says the sovereignists must make a virage, a sharp turn. It's not what Parizeau likes to hear. Now it's no holds barred warfare. Parizeau's authority is in doubt.
Monsieur Parizeau, avez-vous l'impression que vous êtes encore vraiment le patron du oui?
One reporter confronts Parizeau with the question that's on everyone's minds. Is he still the boss?
Je suis premier ministre du Québec.
Le midi 15 avec Michel Lacombe.
The very next day, Bouchard ups the ante.
Monsieur Bouchard, pourquoi avez-vous tenu à parler vous-même de virage?
Parce qu'il faut un virage. Manifestement, il faut un virage. Il me paraît que ce que les gens demandent, c'est un virage.
Jean-François Lisée is listening to the radio broadcast in his car. He knows relations are strained, but he has no inkling of what Lucien Bouchard is about to do.
Moi, c'est une chose que je ne veux pas, monsieur.
And then the question is asked, well, if you don't have the change that you're asking for, will you participate in the referendum campaign in the fall? And Bouchard says something like, well, that's a good question. You know, we'll have to answer that if that happens. So I said, wow, you know, this is awful. I mean, now we have one of our two leaders who says publicly, I might not be there for the referendum campaign if I don't have my way. So I see the crisis just expanding, you know, and there's no certainty that we're going to survive this crisis.
English Canada gloats. Political cartoonists compare Lucien Bouchard's skewering of Parizeau to the spectacular break between Bouchard and Brian Mulroney over the Meech Lake Accord. Some columnists go as far as declaring, yet again, that separatism is dead. Jacques Parizeau is bruised, his advisors badly shaken. The whole sovereignist plan is in jeopardy. Jean-François Lisée drafts a confidential memo setting out all of the options to defuse the crisis. It's a stark assessment. Lucien Bouchard holds all the cards.
You can't get around the fact that you have a political leader with 72% of the popular vote. Any attempt to reconcile with Monsieur Bouchard would not be credible.
He urges Parizeau to make radical changes to his strategy, to come up with something so bold, so far-reaching, that it will not be perceived as giving in to Bouchard.
Something that you can sell as an historic event.
That's exactly what he does. Parizeau reaches out to Mario Dumont, the young leader of Quebec's third party, the Action Démocratique. Dumont is not a separatist, but one of many Federalists who soured on Canada after the death of the Meech Lake Accord. He embodies the ambivalence of many Quebecers who could vote either way in the referendum. Jacques Parizeau is much too hardline for them, but they listen to Dumont. Dumont also wants Quebec to offer a partnership to the rest of Canada. This time, in the spirit of compromise and cooperation, Parizeau can give in without losing face.
The only reason why I would accept a partnership association, what was the latest, the latest one, Confederal Union, said Mr. Landrieu. Anything, I don't mind, as long as the principle is maintained. If it doesn't work out, then we go it alone. We do it.
On June 12, 1995, in a setting worthy of an international treaty, the three leaders hail the birth of the sovereignist coalition. Despite its rough start, it will hold together until the night of the referendum. For many Federalists, the agreement is nothing more than a stunt. Jean Chrétien calls it a mirage. But the American Consul General in Quebec City sees things very differently. Her confidential report to the State Department is prophetic.
Canadians and Quebecers would be well advised to fasten their seatbelts. The sovereignty train has left the station and is picking up speed. We're lucky we can stay on the sidelines. It is likely to be a rough ride.
In early September 1995, an audience of a chosen few gather in Quebec City for a very special occasion. A proclamation is read. With strong echoes of the American Declaration of Independence, it indicts the old country, Canada, for its failure to recognize the fundamental rights of its Quebec citizens. Then, it proclaims the birth of the new country of Quebec.
Le Québec est un pays souverain.
And for a brief moment, 1 month before the start of the referendum campaign, Jacques Parizeau gets to live his dream, the declaration of Quebec's independence. But this is only a dress rehearsal. The people of Quebec have not yet spoken. For now, it is nothing more than poetry and show, a ceremony for longtime supporters of Quebec independence, those who have fought alongside Parizeau for more than a quarter century. Jacques Parizeau believes he's going to win. He's made so many compromises to make it happen. He's clearly moved by this moment of anticipated glory. His partners are not. Lucien Bouchard is not here, nor is Mario Dumont. Dumont refers to the event as high mass. He feels that this kind of show is too elitist, that it does nothing to show average Quebecers how sovereignty would improve their fate. For Lucien Bouchard, it's nothing more than a sound and light show, and it's simply bad timing. The next day, Jacques Parizeau spells out the long-awaited referendum question.
Acceptez-vous que le Québec devienne souverain après avoir offert formellement au Canada un nouveau partenariat économique et politique dans le cadre du projet de loi sur l'avenir du Québec et de l'entente signée le 12 juin 1995.
Voulez-vous que le Québec devienne un pays souverain à telle date?
Chrétien quickly attacks the sovereignists, accusing Parizeau of reneging on his promise of a clear and direct question. It's an attack that hurts, because the question is not the one Parizeau would have wanted to ask.
Parce qu'on ne peut pas convaincre les Québécois de quitter le Canada.
The questions I'd like is, do you want Quebec to become a sovereign country at such and such a date? Yes, no. As simple as that. So it's more complicated than the simple-minded question that I prefer. But if I, insofar as I want it, to broaden the base of those who would all be aligned towards the objective of the sovereignty of Quebec, and if I didn't consider that the sovereignty of Quebec was the property of the Parti Québécois, then I had to take into account my allies.
Radio hotlines are flooded.
It's a very clear question, and I like it. It talks about being sovereign and entering into an agreement with Canada, which is what we want.
They want an independent country, but they left the word country out of the question. They're trying to confuse people as much as possible to get the marginal voters to support them.
The question was awful, and the question was not respectful of the electors. You know, it's all very good to say that you're a Democrat and you believe in democracy, etc. But when you fudge your questions to get an answer the way you want it to be, and you fudge the question to a point that you might get a different answer that the electors wants to give because he doesn't know exactly what is a yes and what is a no, I don't think you respect then the democracy.
Those who say that the question is not clear disgust me. I feel they're being insulting to people from Quebec.
Whether it has one word or 5 million words, it will never be clear enough for them.
Toute cette notion de clarté là, je trouve que c'est pas très respectueux de la population. Ça laisse entendre finalement que les gens qui ont pas pensé comme toi le jour du référendum, c'est parce qu'ils ont pas compris là, puis que. La question, elle disait ce qu'elle disait. Puis les gens qui ont voté, là, je sais pas, moi, j'ai pas rencontré au lendemain du référendum là, des citoyens là, qui ont voté et qui savaient pas du tout sur quoi ils votaient.
I am an uneducated laborer and I find it very clear. In fact, I know it by heart.
The question is a reflection of the average Quebecer's lack of political courage. Because the question should be really simple. Do you want a sovereign country, yes or no?
Madame Collins?
It is Jean-François Lisée who drafted the question. He modeled it on the question asked only 3 years earlier during the federal referendum on the Charlottetown Accord.
Acceptez-vous que la Constitution du Canada soit renouvelée?
I took back the 1992 Charlottetown referendum question. This is the most recent referendum we have.
Oui, non.
I said, if it's good enough for Canadians and the Federalist parties, it's good enough for me. And the electorate is attuned to this kind of question because they have just voted on it.
Moi, je n'accepte pas la question.
Canadian political leaders quickly condemn it.
Le Québécois ne veulent pas l'astuce.
I think this question will be doomed, especially if we can tear off the mask, if I may use those words, which I think is behind this question or covering this question.
I had hoped that the Premier would have presented a question that was straightforward. Do you want to separate from Canada or do you not?
It will be their last intervention for a while. At this same moment, Quebec Federalists fan out across the country with a message for English-Canadian politicians and journalists. It's our fight. Stay out of it. Let us handle it. Don't make Quebecers mad, or they might vote yes. Some columnists, like William Gold of the Calgary Herald, sneer at the advice. But the message gets through. Canada keeps quiet.
It was very difficult to see how we could configure an election campaign and a referendum campaign in Quebec with the intervention of people from outside of Quebec trying to influence the choice. How could we do that without leaving the impression to Quebecers that someone from outside was trying to direct them?
If we had clear questions, they are asking to the people of Canada, do you want sovereignty?
And they say at the same time that they want to stay in Canada. The Economist last week had the title, they want a divorce today and they want to be lovers tomorrow. So it's not a very clear question, Mr. Speaker.
You know, my view is if it is a clear question with clear majority, I can accept that. But not with the tricky question with, a vote that means other things. You know, it has to be clear.
Reform leader Preston Manning is one English-Canadian who will not be silenced. He wants Jean Chrétien to spell out the consequences of a yes vote in the referendum.
Will the Prime Minister make clear that a yes vote means Quebec is on its way out, that a no vote means Quebec is in the Federation for a long haul, and that 50% plus one is the dividing line between those two positions?
Mr. Speaker, I'm asking in this House of Commons, since a lot of time, gave us a real question, an honest, clear question on separation, but they have clouded the issue, talking about divorce and remarriage at the same time, and they want me, on behalf of all Canadians, to say that with a clouded question like that, with one vote, I will help them to destroy Canada. You might, I won't, not, Mr. Manning.
He didn't agree that the question they were asking was a legitimate question, so we said, okay, what would be a legitimate question? He started to question whether a 50% vote was enough. Okay, if that's not, what is? And why not, if you've got a view on this, the government has a view on it, why not put it in legislation? Here's what we consider a legitimate question, here's what we consider a legitimate outcome of the vote. And he would resist that, not only resist it, he'd accuse anybody that raised it of being divisive and treasonous.
And I'm very disappointed that the leader of the Reform Party is trying to position himself in a situation like that. I would like to tell him that as Canadians, we have to be united to make sure that Quebec remains.
Jean Chrétien is entangled in a process over which he has no control. But that doesn't worry him for now. He's convinced that the Federalists will win easily.
Ce qui me désole, c'est de voir un gouvernement
qui veut montrer le piège que M. Parizeau nous attend.
Although the referendum campaign is not officially underway, the Federalist forces in Quebec launch a massive preemptive strike. They attack their opponents' economic arguments, a strategy that served them well in 1980. And they've added a new twist. They savage Jacques Parizeau's credibility.
On jurait que pour Jacques Parizeau, l'échec de ses offres est planifié et programmé.
Daniel Johnson is the Liberal leader in Quebec. He questions Jacques Parizeau's real intentions. Parizeau is going to make an offer of partnership that is deliberately meant to fail, he says.
C'est planifié, c'est programmé, ça, l'échec de cette offre-là. On va garder le dollar canadien, l'espace économique canadien, on va garder la LENA, on va garder la...
Jean Charest mocks the sovereignists for wanting independence, but also the Canadian dollar and the passport.
Je comprends leur fierté, ils sont fiers d'être Canadiens aussi.
Il est exclu qu'un État rapetissé...
The president of Bombardier warns that his company could pull up stakes if the yes side wins.
Le développement de ce type d'entreprise.
S'il vous plaît.
And finally, they say that winning isn't enough. They must crush the sovereignists.
Il faut écraser.
The blitz is devastating. Jacques Parizeau can still put off calling the referendum. To go ahead with it now seems like political suicide.
En pleine forme, M. Parizeau.
Oui, ça va.
Star radio host Gilles Prou can't believe what he's hearing. He tries to cajole him into announcing a postponement, but Parizeau will have none of it. His resolve is unshakable.
Je dis que c'est le 30 octobre. Voulez-vous me croire, hein? Croyez-moi, je vous assure.
The referendum will be on October 30th. End of discussion.
Je vous dis que c'est le 30.
We heard the referendum is going to be postponed.
Oh, yes, I'm sure that you've heard about that. Would you please believe me when I say it's October 30th? You never believe me. I don't know why. I assure you that it'll be on October 30th. Why don't you believe me?
On October 1st, he makes it official. Quebecers will go to the polls in 30 days.
I think we'll make it. I think we'll have a country pretty soon.
The sovereignists seem to have a rendezvous with disaster.
Mr. Premier, why did you decide to issue the writ, even though you seem to be trailing quite badly among public opinion?
I don't think we're trailing all that badly. On the contrary, we've had, a remarkable week.
Despite his optimism, the campaign starts off badly. Parizeau lacks the common touch.
We were hitting a ceiling, you know, in the writings and the door-to-door. People were saying, well, I'm not against it, but, you know, Parizeau...
The new American consul in Quebec City is monitoring the campaign closely. He writes to Washington.
Pro-sovereignty strategists believe that if the next round of published polls don't show some progress, their battle for a sovereign Quebec will be lost.
For Lucien Bouchard, it's his worst nightmare come true, to be caught in a losing referendum campaign. But there's not much more he can do. After all, it's Parizeau's show. In the no camp, everything is going according to plan. Daniel Johnson, leader of the Quebec Liberal Party, is driving the campaign. Although not very charismatic, he is well respected, particularly on economic issues. This is the No Fighting Force. It's an impressive collection of Quebec and federal politicians, as well as prominent business leaders. But despite its apparent strength, this is a very fragile coalition. Many of the politicians here are bitter opponents, but the referendum law forces them to campaign under one banner.
The way it's structured in the referendum law, it's a distraction for the no side, because you have to live with people who have all sorts of arguments when you work really hard as the leader of the forces to have a, you know, sort of a consistent line to put before the electorate.
For the moment, the differences matter little. The no camp is ahead, and that's all that counts. Their attacks are hitting home, and everyone here is happy. Their strategy is a carbon copy of the one used in the 1980 campaign, and they are expecting the same results.
Merci, merci. Merci beaucoup. Et vous, Monsieur Johnson, je voudrais vous remercier parce que vous faites un travail tout à fait exceptionnel dans cette campagne.
Jean Chrétien has been convinced to keep a low profile. On October 6th, he makes his first campaign speech. It's in his hometown of Shawinigan.
Vous les avez écrasés à l'Assemblée nationale.
Being a political person, it was a bit frustrating for me to remain removed from some element of it. But I said nothing, you know, on some way that it was operated. And it was a bit frustrating because it is not my nature and my political instinct.
It's not in Jean Chrétien's nature to be cast as a supporting player in Daniel Johnson's show, but he performs his diminished role graciously, convinced that they are crushing the opposition. Neither of the two men have any idea of the firestorm that will hit them the very next day. After a disastrous first week of campaigning, Jacques Parizeau has had to make a wrenching choice, whether to put his dream at risk or to yield center stage.
Mes amis, il me fait grand plaisir de vous présenter celui qui sera le 31 octobre, le négociateur en chef des Québécois, M. Lucien Bouchard.
In a surprising move, Parizeau virtually hands over the leadership to Lucien Bouchard by naming him chief negotiator for Quebec. The crowd's enthusiasm confirms that he's made the right choice. Bouchard is clearly the more popular man. Parizeau's wife knows how much he's hurting.
Jacques Parizeau voulait gagner. Alors, c'était la chose à faire. Puis il l'a fait de bon cœur. Mais je vous dis pas que ça s'est fait sans pincement à son orgueil et puis sans pincement, c'est certain. Hein? Mais il était prêt à tous les sacrifices.
C'est de gagner. C'est de gagner. Il faut imaginer tout même pas que j'ai passé autant d'années de ma vie pour perdre pour des affaires d'ego.
The campaign goes into overdrive. Bouchard's presence is like a bolt of lightning.
Monsieur Chrétien a dit hier qu'il était content parce que, pense-t-il, Daniel Johnson a écrasé le gouvernement Parizeau.
He lashes out at Jean Chrétien and Daniel Johnson. They want to crush us, he says. Mr. Johnson likes that.
Il aime ça du monde écrasé. C'est comme ça qu'il nous voit.
That's how he sees us. That's how he wants us. Crushed.
Il y a beaucoup d'enseignements à tirer des paroles de M. Chrétien. C'est toujours très profond, ce qu'il dit.
He makes fun of Jean Chrétien. Then he taunts him with the fact that the yes side is just getting started. And that with 3 weeks to go to October 30th, nothing is over yet.
Il devrait savoir qu'à 3 semaines du 30 octobre, rien n'est fini, que tout commence, et que nous allons le remporter le 30 octobre.
While Bouchard leads the crowd in a triumphant chant, the Federalists also cry victory. Parizeau is being ousted by Bouchard.
Oui, on va gagner. Oui, on va gagner.
When you really look at it and you want to be very brutal about it, it'll look very much like a coup d'etat. Why would Mr. Parizeau, which has been his lifelong dream, would give that up? Unless he was forced to.
What do you think the impact will be of the fact that Mr. Bouchard has taken over the Yes campaign?
To Jean Chrétien, this is great news. The enemy is on the run.
Well, for me, it's not us who had to change the strategy. It's them. And changing the driver of the bus is going to separation anyway.
To the sovereignists, it's like the song says, a new dawn.
Les changements profonds, ils ne se trouvent que du côté du oui. Le oui est porteur de changements. On va alors renvoyer leur constitution qui ont voulu nous imposer d'une façon antidémocratique.
One of the most anxiously awaited polls in a long time is out tonight. The results suggest a slightly tighter race compared to polls reported last week.
C'est le temps qu'on sorte du marasme. C'est le temps qu'on sorte de la torpeur du Québec.
He had came close to die a few months before, and he was handicapped suddenly, and whatever. Anyway, the people thought that he was the Messiah. And, you know, people were asking him to bless the Quebec flag. Come on. And so we had to... to live with that reality. It was very unusual. I was extremely surprised, and even if I'm a pro, I did not anticipate that at all.
Even when Lucien Bouchard slips badly, it doesn't seem to matter to anyone. When he refers to Quebecers as one of the white races with the lowest birth rates, hardly an eyebrow is raised.
Imagine if me, I had said things like that. You know, you have seen the Globe and Mail and National Post and all the gang dumping by the truckload on me. And in Quebec, nobody picked up the pen and said, that makes no sense. And I, you know, so I had to fight back.
When we did focus group studies to try to measure this effect, we were stunned to see that the people found no fault in the man. Even when we showed contradictions, people didn't believe it. We even had a particular focus group that where one of the spokesperson, or at least one of the participants, said, he's such a handsome man. And I mean, people were like completely in another planet when it came down to examining Lucien Bouchard and what he represented.
Moving Bouchard into the limelight turns out to have been a stroke of genius. The title of negotiator and his own reputation give credibility to the idea of a partnership with Canada. He's the new leader now, and the sovereignists seem to be surfing on a wave to victory. The Montreal Convention Center, 12 days before the referendum, the elite of Montreal's business community has turned out to support the no side. Lucien Bouchard has been barnstorming the province for 10 days now, but the no campaign seems stuck in a time warp.
Pendant que Jacques Parizeau est en vol plané au-dessus de la réalité.
The Federalists' message has not changed at all. They're patting each other on the back and firing at the wrong target, Jacques Parizeau.
C'est ça, la différence entre Laurent Beaudoin et Jacques
Parizeau. Is flying without a parachute, he says, while Bombardier's president makes real planes, real money, and real jobs.
Merci de m'avoir peur de faire valoir tes convictions.
Even Jean Charest, the most passionate of the no campaigners, doesn't quite know how to counter Lucien Bouchard's charisma.
Comme orateur, Monsieur Bouchard, bravo. Comme économiste, zéro.
His adversaries could never quite find the way to counter his campaign. It took some time before the no side realized what was happening to them. They weren't convinced of it from the outset. And mind you, the no campaign had gone on at such a predictable rate for a long time. This change happened so suddenly that I think it probably took them a little while to figure out that this was really happening to them.
Mon nom est Phil O'Brien. Je suis président du conseil de Devon.
The no coalition is shaken. The businessmen feel that the politicians are being far too cautious, and they're not afraid to say so.
Les gens d'affaires travaillent au développement du Québec.
Phil O'Brien says he expects political leaders to work hard, with vision and passion, like members of the business community do.
I hate managing things through fear. You cannot manage things through fear. You know, fear is a worse thing to work with, because there's no aspiration, there's no hope, there's no challenge, you haven't got the chemistry to do things, you're always looking behind you. So it was a result of the management of the no campaign. It was almost like a philosophy of fear, putting blocks here and there. You didn't feel that with the committee of the week. You know, the yes were, there was no fear. There was hope, there was passion, and we were on two different planets.
That same evening, there's undeniable proof of a sea change. For the first time, a poll shows the yes in the lead.
43.6% of those surveyed said they'll vote yes. 42.6% said they'll vote no.
The shockwaves rock the country from one end to the other. The rest of Canada will no longer be silenced.
A separate Quebec would be a foreign country, period. Anything else is wishful thinking.
Some politicians are outraged. They question Jean Chrétien's judgment, and most of all, they blame him and his advisors for having been overconfident.
I try not to be negative on this, but I think there was also I would use the word arrogance. Others might use, well, we're far more experienced than you. Certainly condescending view from Chrétien, Goldenberg, et al., that we've been around here, we understand this, you're newly elected here, go with your little welfare reforms, and we know your tax cuts won't work, but go ahead and blow your brains out and stay out of this area. We understand it, you don't.
I would search for some sign of, a bigger strategy, and I couldn't find it. I'd ask about strategy, and he'd get into tactics. He'd get talking about the last time, because I remember the last time it was Trudeau was the brains of the operation, and Chrétien was the field guy. And Chrétien played a major role, but it was at that role. And so he'd get talking about how the last time they got the health department tied up half the billboards in Quebec, and then they'd had them for the campaign, and wasn't this great? That's great. But I'm talking now I didn't say it this way. You're the brains of the operation. You're supposed to have the big plan, you know, and I didn't see it there.
Canadians pour out their frustrations.
I can't believe that we've heard so little from our political leaders. They've been pretty quiet till now. And the country, well, is falling apart. They should have tried to be more passionate about our country a long time ago, and maybe it wouldn't have come to this.
I'm very frustrated that as an Ontarian, I haven't had any chance to express myself or to take part in any of this, the whole thing. I'm looking at the breakup of my country as a bystander. There's nothing I can really do.
Anxiety spreads like a virus in all parts of Canada. It seeps into the very heart of the Chrétien government.
One of the things that bothered me was that throughout there was a view that this was a Quebec fight, that the rest of you really, you know, we know what we're doing. Yeah, give us your views, but this is our fight. We know Quebec, and we'll make the strategy. I found that really unacceptable, and I had a number of conversations with Mr. Chrétien about my unease, about the way we were going, and I think other ministers did. And I think he started to realize that that there was a possibility that the yes side could win.
The federal forces have not really done a good job. I mean, they really, there's a lot of questions that Quebecers had that have not been answered by Jean Chrétien, because he was not around at the beginning of the referendum.
They hoped that by ignoring it, that it would go away, and it's now very clear that they may have made a tremendously bad strategic blunder.
This status quo campaign, this cautious campaign, this walking on eggs, this leave it to somebody else, it's none of our business campaign, this claim by Mr. Bouchard and by others that the rest of us in Canada didn't care, his campaign was working very well and ours wasn't, and we needed to do something to turn it around.
There was no plan B. How come there was no plan B?
Everybody wasn't the hell of a plan A.
Well, everybody in Quebec fully expected Mr. Bouchard to have a very big impact.
Yes.
And how disconnected can the no side be not to have foreseen that?
It was sad. We felt powerless. I felt completely impotent in the context of my country. It was a terrible feeling.
Canadians are in a state of shock. Their political leaders had assured them that the Federalist cause would triumph. And now, all of a sudden, without warning, their country is on the verge of collapse. U.S. Ambassador James Blanchard has been pressing his government to take a strong stand in favor of Canada for months now. He thinks the U.S. position is being distorted by the French language media. After these latest polls, he's in no mood for diplomacy.
I'm telling you, the press coverage of what the U.S. people would say in Quebec was outrageously inaccurate, including things I said. It was outrageously inaccurate. And any janitor in the State Department could have said, I liked Quebec, and it would be State Department official hails new nation.
Now, Washington is ready to heed his advice. Secretary of State Warren Christopher is the first to do so. On October 18th, as he comes out of a meeting with Canadian External Affairs Minister André Ouellette, a reporter asks a question about the referendum. Christopher repeats the American mantra.
I say I don't want to try to participate in the internal debate there in any way.
And then he goes further.
I think we shouldn't take for granted that a different kind of organization would be just obviously have exactly the same kind of ties.
I said, is that it? Is that the worst they can do? How many people understood what he meant? So we said, well, if that's it, that's fine. But then the very next day, people wised up on the no side, said, well, this won't help much, so we need more. And so we have from an American diplomat tells us that the pressure is great on the White House to step up and say something that would have an impact. What could that be? Well, we think that something that would have an impact would be some pronouncement on economic consequences, on American investment, on GM, on whatever. And we knew that this was an argument that had traction on the Quebec electorate. So we feared that. So I said, what should we do?
What they do is try to intimidate the American government the next day by letter.
If the yes side wins, as is now probable, Quebec voters and the historians will remember that the sovereignty of Quebec was achieved despite or even against the American will.
Jean-François Lisée drafts the letter. Bernard Landry signs it and hands it over to U.S. Consul General Steve Kelly.
I thought it made him look goofy and bad. It was a veiled threat to the U.S. and to Warren Christopher. And Christopher didn't know who Bernard Landry was. I just told him to take it, put it in the drawer.
The Quebec government is desperate to prevent President Bill Clinton from making any statement during the last week of the campaign. It was a daring but ill-conceived gamble. The American answer will come within the week. Friday, October 20th, Raymond Chrétien, Canada's ambassador to the U.S., is on Wall Street, where politics are not so much debated as calculated. He's agreed some time ago to speak to a group of influential investors. He gives his usual upbeat speech about the merits of investing in Canada. But these business leaders read the papers and they track the polls.
Question after question, comment after comment, telling me, listen, we heard you with interest, but we're watching very carefully what's happening in Quebec. We're not sure that you're going to win this one. It's so, so tight that both sides can win.
That same evening, Jean Chrétien arrives in New York to attend the 50th anniversary celebrations at the United Nations. At the posh Hotel Pierre, he has supper with his nephew Raymond, who is visibly shaken.
I told him, as soon as you leave this hotel tomorrow morning, as soon as you arrive at the United Nations, you'll be flooded with questions concerning what is going to happen, where do you stand, are you going to win, is it not dangerous that you could lose, that kind of. So I wanted to just warn him that the perception among those with a direct interest, among those Americans with a direct interest in Quebec and Canada, was that it was too close to call. For me, it was also an opportunity to suddenly realize that we didn't have a plan B. You know, my point was, what do I do in a week? What do I tell President Clinton, his government, if Canada loses that? What's our message? Do we accept? Do we refuse? Conditions? So that was a pretty important issue for us to deal with. And my job in Washington was to to relate to the American administration what our position was on the, and at that time, let me tell you, there was a lot of skating around.
The next day, Jim Blanchard has set things up so that Jean Chrétien and Bill Clinton will casually run into each other at the UN. Both are on a diplomatic tightrope. Chrétien can't officially ask for help, and Clinton can't offer it, but the two men understand each other perfectly.
But I had heard some rumors that it was that we were not doing as well, so I must have said it's getting tough. And he was under pressure to make a comment by his own press. So he told that to me, if I recall, and I said, hey, good, boy, you know, if you speak up your mind, type of thing I might have said to him.
He asked him to help, but he didn't. That was in New York. He asked him to help. He didn't get into this side or the other.
That same day, in Montreal, the no strategists are in shock. A new internal poll shows the yes ahead by 7 points. That rekindles simmering tensions between the Quebec Liberals and the federal Liberals. It's no time for mistakes. With his friend Bob Ray at his side, Daniel Johnson is on Montreal's South Shore. He's asked if he'd like Jean Chrétien to say before the vote that he will recognize Quebec as a distinct society in the Constitution. Johnson hopes he will.
He may or may not wish to say somewhat more pointed, have some more pointed remarks or specific remarks. I believe that to the extent that they echo what we're saying, of course, it's desirable.
In New York, Chrétien doesn't echo his wishes.
No desire at this time to debate the Constitution. For the next 8 days, we're concentrating on the cause of keeping Canada together, the best country in the world, according to the United Nations.
The result is a media firestorm. It couldn't have come at a worse time. The No campaign is in free fall. Their troubles come as an unexpected gift for the sovereignist camp.
Monsieur Johnson, ne comprenez-vous pas que vous êtes dans le camp du non? Avez-vous compris?
Lucien Bouchard plays it for all it's worth. He makes fun of Johnson. He reminds Johnson that Chrétien has always said no to all of Quebec's constitutional demands.
Est-ce que vous persistez, Monsieur Johnson, à remettre à Jean Chrétien, cet homme qui vous a déjà dit?
He welcomes Johnson to the growing ranks of Quebecers who've been told no by Jean Chrétien.
Est-ce que vous persistez à vouloir lui confier l'avenir du Québec?
Lucien Bouchard is bitingly sarcastic, and he's devastating.
En faire le maître du destin du Québec? Vous savez que c'est non!
I recall just having a sinking feeling in my stomach. That we were going from bad to worse. I could not believe that Daniel Johnson would be speaking without Ottawa having their answers already prepared and scripted as well. And I don't know where communications fell down, but it definitely was a very bad weekend for us.
I felt coming away from that weekend that a victory for the yes was a distinct possibility.
That same Sunday, about a dozen federal cabinet ministers meet for dinner in an upscale restaurant in Hull. For the first time, they have to contemplate a future which until now was unthinkable. A Canada without Quebec.
Frankly, we're a group of ministers from English Canada. We talked about our fears, our concerns. We talked about how the campaign was going. We didn't get into a scenario in any kind of detail of what happens if the referendum's lost, but we at least looked at each other and acknowledged that that was a real possibility, and that if that occurred, we would, it couldn't be business as usual. We'd have to ask the hard questions, like, can a prime minister from Quebec represent Canada in a negotiation where there's just been a mandate given to break up this country? Can the team from Quebec, who at that point, remember, occupied all of the main positions in the government of Canada and the cabinet of Canada, could they comprise the negotiating team for Canada
if the subject of negotiation was the sovereignty of Quebec? The answer is they couldn't. That the structure of the government would have to change dramatically. How? We didn't come to that. We only knew that we would take up our duties if called upon, if the result was... Now, nobody wanted that result, obviously. Everybody detested that result. But we at least looked each other in the eye and said, if it is necessary for us to ask these hard questions and to develop the appropriate answers and to seek the collaboration of other parties in Parliament, we'll do our jobs.
This strange campaign, already full of emotion and surprises, hasn't reached its climax yet. There are still 7 days to go. No one who lived through those days will ever forget what happened during that week.